Thank you, Beth. It's great to see everybody. I'm Suzanne Loprior with Zenith Workers' Compensation Carrier, and I'm here to introduce Traci Brown. Traci Brown is a body language expert and a leader in training people to build their bottom line by detecting deception. She's a frequent guest on TV, interpreting the body language of criminals and politicians, and sometimes both labels describe the same person. Traci, you said they'd laugh more than that. She even helps lawyers pick and persuade a jury using body language. Here's a couple of fun facts. She's got a deal with Kevin Harrington, one of the sharks from the hit ABC TV show Shark Tank. She's a former member of the U.S. National Cycling Team. Her new book, How to Detect Lies, Fraud, and Identity Theft, is hot off the presses. And this just in, she's the executive producer of a new TV series, Truth, Lies, and Cover-Ups. All right, so we're in for some fun. She's going to share with us some secrets of exactly how to tell whose pants are actually on fire. Get ready. It's about to get hot in here. But please hold your applause until after this sizzling video.
Traci Brown has learned to take a look at President Donald Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden. She told us she could see plenty without having to hear a thing.
Saw a guy who many thought might have even been medicated, who seemed, in most cases, emotionless. But you said you saw a lot in what he did do.
We watched the interview alongside Traci Brown, who actually raced with Armstrong on the USA Cycling program in the early 90s. Now Traci is a body language expert who specializes in being able to tell whether or not someone is lying.
Fire marshal is on standby. It's about to get hot in here. Please welcome to the stage, Traci Brown.
Good afternoon. How's everybody doing? You having a fun time? Isn't this new resort cool? Like, it's super cool. How about a big high five for everybody who put this together? Or how about a round of applause? That would be a little bit better. Now, as much fun as we're having, I got bad news to report. People's pants are on fire around you all the time, and you haven't even noticed. And those lies, they cost you big. I mean, time, money, and energy. So it's a good thing you came today, because all that loss stops now. My goal is for you to walk out of here knowing how to tell truth from lies and fact from fiction. How would that be? Sound good? Yeah, excellent. So just think for a minute. How would life be different? Can you make my mic just a little bit less hot? I'm kind of blowing it out a little bit. How would life be different if people's pants really did catch on fire whenever they lied? You ever thought about that? Like, things would change, don't you think? Things like buying a new or a used car would get a lot easier. A lot easier, right? Because you'd know when the salesman said, "This beauty's the best one on the lot, starts up every time, never been in a wreck," right? You'd know the truth. I think politics would get a lot more fun to watch too, right? I think our candidates would have to have a staff firefighter follow them around with a hose and hose them down every time they open their mouths, right? Or, dating apps might turn your phone into a fire hazard, right? You'd have to be really careful who you swiped right on. Now, sadly, we're never going to see flames whenever someone lies. But don't worry, because I've got the next best thing. You see, I've been lucky enough to study right alongside some of our country's top law enforcement. FBI, police, Green Berets, and people I believe could not tell me they were in the CIA. I have boiled it down for you here today, and you're going to be blown away by how cool this is, because it's all in the body language. Now, I get to use this information on a daily basis. I get calls to work on investigations, and in the media calls me just about every day to comment on big events, things that change the fate of the world. Crimes, politics, billion-dollar business deals, and if the couples on The Bachelor are really in love. It's fascinating, and I never run out of things to talk about. Now, I didn't get started reading body language because I'm involved with FBI or CIA that you know about, although I think I'd make a pretty good spy. No, I got started reading body language from bike racing. You saw from the video, I got to be a really good bike racer, but when I first started, that wasn't the case. I found out really quickly that cycling at the elite level, at the core of the elite level, cycling is for little people. And I'm a big person. I got all 5'9" of me to drag around. So I had to find some different ways to keep up. Because the problem in cycling, do we have any cyclists with us? Do we have any cyclists? One? Okay, yeah. So you understand, the problem is, in cycling, if you can't keep up, they leave you. They leave you behind, and you've got to find your way home. And I had had enough of that. So I started to understand that my competition was broadcasting exactly what was on their mind, exactly how they were feeling, and exactly what was going to happen next. And when I could get a unique read on each individual and react to what they were about to do, maybe even before they knew they were going to do it, that's when I began to win. And it's the same in your business. Like, the things that you're going to look for are different, right? The things, like, from your members and from your board, like, you can better inform your most important decisions when you know what people aren't saying and what they're planning in their mind and what's going to happen next. Here's the camera. Okay. So, you're going to look for different things. And we're going to get into some of that. Now, I needed this. I needed this because, you see, I jumped into the deep into cycling without even knowing it. And I it was so important that I kept track of it right here. This is my training journal from all those years ago, right? Because I was a little fish in a big pond. And I kept track of everyone that I thought was important. And I needed it because there was this guy, he kept showing up to the training rides. And he was in the races, like when I would jump in the men's race and race right alongside him. His name was Lance. And he was really fast. Yeah, Lance Armstrong. No joke, right? And it's a good thing that I had this information because it helped me in so many situations. Just not have to ride home alone. But when I got good at this, when I started to understand that I could keep records on everyone, maybe in the book or maybe just in my mind, that because they had a pattern. Everyone has a pattern that they use. And they do it over and over and over again. And I kept track of it right here. And it's the same in your world too. Right? So when you can start to get a handle on people and understand that we're all creatures of habit, you're going to start to be able to win as well. Now, the thing about it is that Lance was one of those guys, and you probably have these kind of people that you're dealing with every day, one of those guys where you just know something's up, and you know it's no good, but you don't know what it is. Do you have people like that in your life? Yeah, it wouldn't be anybody in here. Like, it wouldn't be anybody in here, but, like, the people, like, outside of here, yeah, whether it's your members or your vendors or maybe someone on your staff, right? I just thought I had a hunch all those years ago, but it's been revealed, right, that he was the biggest fraud, the biggest cheat in all of sports, been stripped of 7 Tour de France titles for performance-enhancing drugs that he never did, that he denied, right? And it wasn't just me. Like, we all knew something was going on. Looking back, the signs were all there. The signs of deception were all there. And I just thought today, what we ought to do is put some science behind the hunches you have, because that's what I thought I had. I just thought I had a hunch all those years ago. It took a while for the truth to shake out, right? So let's put some science behind the hunches you have so you don't have to wait all that time for the truth to reveal itself. Sound good? Okay, good deal. Now, first thing we're going to do, because I know it's the afternoon, and some of you have coffee, you're trying to stay up. Don't worry, I'm going to keep you up. You want to play a game? Anybody want to play a game? All right, cool. So here's what I want you to do. The first thing you got to understand is that when you want to start to understand body language, you want to start to know who's lying, you got to pay attention. You got to pay attention differently, and most of us are paying so much attention to ourselves, we're just not paying attention to what's going on outside of us. So here's what I want you to do. Get yourself silently, well, this is a silent part of the exercise, get yourself a buddy. Just look at someone and go, yep, you're my buddy. Take 5 seconds, get a buddy. It's hard to keep this group silent, isn't it? That's all right. I like it. All right, you got a buddy? All right, cool. Here's what you're going to do now. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. If your eyes are open, I can see you. I know who you are. Close them. And in your mind, make a picture of your buddy. Make a picture of your buddy. So notice, what color's your shirt? We got some snappy dressers in here. Your eyes are open. I can see you. Your eyes are open. What color's their shirt? What color's their hair? Are they wearing their name tag? What's sitting in front of them? How are their feet? What are their hands doing? Glasses, jewelry. Take 5 more seconds. Make a full picture. All right, you got it? Cool. Here's what you're going to do. Open your eyes. Take a look at your buddy. Take 30 seconds. Tell him what you got right, what you got wrong. Ready? Go. Exercise is over. How'd you do?
Awesome.
Okay, I got awesome and I didn't do very good. How many of you feel great about how you did? You're like, yeah, I got a lot of things right. Raise them high. Be very proud. Be proud. Let's see how we're doing. Oh, okay. Now, even if you got a lot of things right, how many of you are surprised at what you got wrong? The things you just didn't see right in front of you? Yeah. Yeah. So when you want to start to understand who's lying, you got to pay attention differently. And I learned this from bike racing. I learned this the hard way. Now, as good as I thought I was, because I grew up in Dallas, and I moved to Boulder, Colorado. That's where I live right now. And I was going to go there to race bikes and go to see you. And I met my coach when I got there, and his name was Wally. His name still is Wally. Big cowboy guy. Not the kind of guy you'd expect to be a cycling coach. He was the kind of guy to take us out, run us through the hardest workout you could possibly stand, put you in the car, take you home, cook you a hand-cut thick bacon sandwich like it was good for you. That was the kind of guy Wally was. And he'd tell me this at times that were really inconvenient. He'd say, you know what, Trace? You got to pay attention or you pay with pain. And he was right. And he was right. And it hurt to hear that every time. But when you pour your whole entire life into just getting across a finish line before anyone else, and you don't because you're not paying attention, that's a lot of pain. Right? And so I just started thinking, what's the pain of not paying attention in your business? You ever thought of it? It's lost time, lost money, and lost energy. And here's the real problem, is that lies compound. And every time they compound, they take you further and further away from the conversation you need to be having and closer to being on the front page for the wrong reasons, right? So let's try it. You pay attention or you pay with? Let me hear it. That didn't sound painful. Let's try it again. Like, it's meaningful to you, right? You pay attention or you pay with?
Pain.
Oh, that was really good. Okay, cool. So do you want a bonus question just based on that? Yeah, okay, cool. What's different about me now than before you closed your eyes? Yell it out. What's different about me now than before you closed your eyes? What'd you say? I'm holding a green card. Well, yes, I am. You got it on the first try. What's your name?
Kyle.
Kyle, come here, Kyle. Come on up here. This is a $5 Starbucks card for the person who could tell me that I picked it up while your eyes were closed. Big hand, very good. Yeah. Now, how many of you are feeling the pain of not having free Starbucks tomorrow? Yeah, because you pay attention or you pay with what? All right, now that I got your attention, I'm going to let you know we got some surprises coming up. You want to keep paying attention. Because what we're doing through today is raising your sensory acuity, which is a fancy word for how much you pay attention. And I'm going to warn you, this is a one-way street. You are never going to see people the same way again. Right? So let's dive in. Now, here's more bad news. You lie every day. Every day you lie. And I can hear what you're saying in your mind. You're saying, Traci, I go to church. I would never lie. Yes, you lie every day. Now, not all these lies are big and evil and fraudulent. A lot of these lies are just little lies, just to smooth things over, make someone feel better, get out of a conversation more quickly. Things like, you ever been to your 20 or 30 year high school reunion? And you see someone across the way you hadn't seen in a while? And in your mind, you go, time's not been good to them, right? That's what you say. But what comes out of your mouth? What comes out of your mouth? You go, oh, you haven't changed a bit. You look fantastic. You recognize this girl? Yeah, this is my seventh grade best. It was. And you can see, if I haven't changed for the better, don't tell me. But you can see, I still like big hair. Just little lies, right? But you tell them all the time. Or things like, I'm so sorry I didn't call you back. My phone died. I'm so sorry. Now, we treat our phones better than we treat our firstborn children. Right? Your phone didn't die. It just makes you a liar. It doesn't make you a bad person, right? This is a liar. Those things don't always intersect, okay? So other lies you may have told. Things like, I'm sure everyone in this room, more than any group I've ever spoken with, has said this. Tell them I'm in a meeting. I'm in a meeting. I'm not going to be able to talk. Right. Yeah. You're laughing because it's true and you're a liar. Okay. So all different kinds of lies. Now, here's one everyone is told. Okay. Well, everyone's told this one, but more universally, everyone has told this one. Yes, I have read and agreed to the terms and conditions on this website. Now, if you have actually read the terms and conditions on the website, please keep doing what you're doing and report back to the rest of us, okay? We need you. We need you out there. Now, you might be a nerd, but the nerds are taking over, all right? So help the rest of us out. Now, does anybody want permission to lie? Does anybody want permission to lie in one little instance? Anybody?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, mostly it's guys that say that. Is that you? Back to, it's Robin, right? Robin, right? Okay, yeah. We had dinner last night, and y'all need to watch out for her. Okay, so when you get asked this question, do these jeans make my butt look big? Use your wisdom. Use your wisdom first. The answer is always no, okay? Because everybody knows it doesn't have anything to do with the jeans. Okay, so having said that, let's keep going. There's a lot of different kinds of lies. There's a lot of different kinds of lies out there, okay? And they do different things to the brain, okay? And this is from my studies with the FBI. So you got fabrication, exaggerations, deceptive denials, minimizations, and omissions, Okay? Now, the reason that our body language, also our tone and our words, start to go a little bit haywire when deception is at hand is because of this phenomenon called cognitive load. Okay? The brain is doing too much thinking for it to act naturally. Okay? So there's different levels of cognitive load. So fabrication and exaggeration are very high. Okay? They take a high toll. And then you have minimization. Okay? That's a little easier to do. Deceptive denial, that's super easy. And then omission, that's easier than that, right? So fortunately, body language is going to reveal most all of these. Okay? It's up to you to pay attention. It's up to you to pay attention and just kind of understand, all right, how is all this coming together? Okay, so there's another kind of lie that just like, you know, it's as far as the like, you know, let's call it lifespan of lies in the world. Like, there's a new one that just came out a few years ago. Alternative facts, brand new kind of lie. Hang on. Oh wait, but we got to talk about cognitive load a little bit. Just a little science in here. So cognitive load is how much effort your brain is putting out there, okay? So when load is high, thought processes are interfered with, okay? So we talked about that. Now, there we go, alternative facts is a brand new kind of lie. Now, I'm saying this to get a laugh, right? Because it was funny the first time I said it until I messed it all up. Yeah, but it's the alternative facts that get you every time. It's the alternative facts. It's the lies woven into the truth, right? So things like in your business, I got to interview a few of you, right? And number one thing that you got to watch out for is silent disagreement, right? Both from your members and from your staff, right? Things like, is everything fine? Are you sure? Right? Like, do the members really like that new French wine you're trying to get them on, or would they really just stick with the California kind? Okay. Employees, are the policies really effective, or are you in a situation where you're saying, you know what, we've always done it that way, it's fine. Okay. So these are some of the things you got to know. Did members really make a reservation? Are you sure that they didn't know about that wine event? Okay, all of these different kinds of things. Or on your board, I think that can be very telling, right? To understand if they really have the highest intentions in mind for what they're doing, or do they have some kind of alternate agenda, right? That's very self-serving. So these are the kind of things that you're going to be able to sniff out. And you're really going to want to do it, because there's nothing worse. There's nothing worse than just pouring time and money and energy into a project, into a member, into even an event, right? Or a vendor, and just having it come up dry. What just happened? What just happened? I see you're very upset about this, right? I can see. Yeah. So here's the thing. When things disappear out of your life, out of your world, and you feel happily hoodwinked, like maybe like right now, possibly, right? If you're not too upset with me, which I can see that you are. Okay, so when things disappear out of your world like that, there's when you feel like, oh, like that was pretty cool, there's a word for that. It's called magic. When things disappear out of your world that you really wish you had back, like time and money and energy, and the chances of you getting it back are super slim, there's a word for that too. It can be called fraud, right? So let's stay on the happy side of things, on the magic side, right? Do you want to know what happened? Yeah, okay, good. What's your name? Come up here. What, say it again? Dan. All right, Dan. Big hand for Dan. Come on up, Dan. Come on up here. All right, I'm going to tell you what happened, Dan. Okay, give me your hand out like this. And now, where are you from?
Florida.
Of course.
Delray
Beach. Okay, very good. Okay. If you had said, like, Kentucky, I'd be like, what? Okay, hand out like this. Okay, very good. Now, I'm going to hit you, all right? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, There you go. I know. So when you don't pay attention, you can end up with a handful of mush. That's instead of like a really cool, nice project. So that's yours.
Standing ovation.
Yeah.
Standing ovation.
There you go. Keep that. Yeah, that's yours. Take that. Take that with you. Oh. Now he doesn't know what to do with it. Now he wishes he didn't. He didn't say. You can pass it around. It's actually pretty cool. So, yeah, alternative facts, right? You got to be careful for those. And we're going to have some tools to do that. So, basically, here's the framework of how things go. Okay. You got assessment in your mind. Okay, so wait, hang on. Let me make sure I get this right. Observation. Okay, so you're going to see what you got. You're going to assess it, make sense of it. Gives you insight and strategy. Okay. Now, we're going to talk mostly today about observation and assessment. And I talked to a hedge fund friend of mine. He's like, you can assess or you can guess. Guessing is very expensive. Okay. What we want to do is better inform your decisions, okay, with some science instead of just guessing, okay, so that you're getting the results that you hope for in any kind of situation, whether it's at work or whether it's at home, okay? So, let's see, and we talked about that, a few arrows. Okay, you get it. Now, the basic premise here, the body can't lie. Words can lie, but the body can't lie, okay? So you want to believe the body first, take the words with a grain of salt. So what that means is for you is we're going to start easy today. We're getting harder as we go. Okay. So whenever someone, an American person, like Western society, okay, this means yes. When they nod their head like this, it means yes. Or this means no. Okay. So you want to look for mismatches between the body language and the words. So if they say, I would never do that. Right? You got a clue. They're telling you. Or you could ask me anything. Ask me anything. Right? Or it can be veiled in sweetness, too. Like, that is a beautiful baby. I had someone take me to task on that. She marched up to me when I was done. She goes, oh, babies are beautiful. And I was like, well, they'll get there, most of them. Okay. Not all of them. Okay. And then Bill Clinton did this to all of us. I did not have sexual relations with that woman. Like right there in front of all of us. Okay. So head nod, head shake, super easy way to get more intel, right? To understand what's below the surface, right? Now, we could talk about body language all day. I thought it'd be better to watch some videos. You want to watch some videos? Yeah, okay, cool. So I got to warn you, it's about to get hot in here, okay? People's pants are going to burst into flames. So from here on out, whenever we see flames on screen, I'm going to say, liar, liar. You're going to say, I know you know what to say. Okay, very good. Let's try it real time. Like you mean it. Like these people are lying to you. Okay, this is personal. This is personal. Ready? Liar, liar. Ooh, you got it. Okay, good. Now, do we have any members of Bachelor Nation with us? Anybody willing to admit you watch The Bachelor? I see. Oh, you're all about it. Okay. All right. I see a few of you getting fidgety. I know who you are. I got you. All right. So you remember from a few years ago, this is Ben. You remember Ben? Yeah. Oh, and the drama was off the charts. The drama was off the charts because Ben was in love with two women. I know. And the show was about to end, and he had to propose to one of them because that's always a good time to propose, is on a tight TV deadline. And so JoJo pins him down, and let's just see, knowing what you know now, what do you think about Ben? Here we go.
Like, I haven't asked you, or do you think that you're at a place with whoever that a proposal is what you would want to do?
Yeah.
Every time I see that, it gets me. I've seen it hundreds of times. Do you think he was ready to propose? Absolutely not. He proposed to the other girl, whose name was, does anybody know her name? Sheila, no, the name wasn't Sheila. Anybody? She had blonde hair. All right, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. Her name was Lauren. And they moved to Denver, not far from me. And they broke up about a year and a half later, right? Because he was lying to himself and he was lying to the ladies. And it's clear as day when you know what to look for, right? Now, talk about a lie compounding. A year and a half of your life that you could spend looking for the right person or being with the right person, but you didn't because you lied. That's like a big ouch. That's a big ouch there. So I think what we got to do here is we got to call it like we see it, and we just got to say, liar, liar. Oh, very good. All right. So you see how this is going to go. Now, no talk from me. Oh, and if you have questions, it's okay. Just raise your hand. Okay, I'll answer questions. Now, no talk from me would be complete without giving Lance Armstrong a hard time, because he deserves it. He does. He almost wrecked our whole entire sport with all the performance-enhancing drugs that he never did, right? And so let's just take a look. We're going to see three little videos. I want you to be ready to vote. How many lies do you see? Okay, so you're going to vote 1, 2, or 3. Now, I'm going to let you know, and I've been letting you know all day, we're starting easy, and we're getting harder as we go. Okay, so be ready to vote. How many lies you see?
I have never doped.
I've never taken performance-enhancing drugs.
My best defense is I've never tested positive.
All right. How many of you voted? 1, 2, raise them high, raise them real high. 3, how many wouldn't vote no matter what I said? You can raise that. Yeah, so a couple of you raised your hand. I appreciate the honesty. Okay, so here's the thing, the answer's three. Now this is not always so cut and dry, okay? We're gonna watch it again. And I want you to see that last one. And the last one is more of an up and down movement, okay? It's not so definitive, okay? And when you get out on the street, you get out and back at your clubs, things may not be as definitive as you would hope, okay? And a lot of times you're going to want more signs than just a head nod or a head shake, but this is stepping into, okay, let's get into some of the art of how we're really starting to watch people differently, okay? Let's rewind it. Watch that third one.
I have never doped.
I've never taken performance-enhancing drugs.
My best defense is I've never tested positive.
There, did you see it? Yeah. You can't unsee it when you see it. And he did test positive. He tested positive twice, and he bought his way out of both of them because cycling thought they needed the story. Cycling's a dying sport. It's hard to watch on TV. It takes a really long time. And they needed a great hero who'd overcome cancer and overcome the whole world. And they got it until they didn't, right? So let's do this. It'll make you feel nice and warm and cozy inside. And you can say, liar, liar. That's right. That's right. Now, how's this going to come about in your world? Well, things like, are you really getting the best deal on that pool renovation, right? Is it going to be up to the quality that you're hoping, okay? Will they complete it on time? That's a big one these days, right? Are they able to get the parts and the supplies, right? That'd be handy to know if there's any doubt on their side. What about, was it really sexual harassment, or is there a brothel running out of your clubhouse? Right. I talked to 2 people who brought that up to me, okay? And we talked about it at dinner last night. She goes, oh, are you talking about that one in Kansas City when they sold it and then that's what they found upstairs? I was like, no, I was talking about the other one that someone else told me about, okay? So be careful. It could happen to you. Remember that front page for the wrong reason thing? Yeah. Pay attention, okay? So let's keep going. Now, the number one thing, yeah, this is good. Do we have any royal watchers? Do we have any royal watchers with us? A few of you? Yeah. You like watching Prince Harry? Yeah. And Meghan? No. She's like, no, I don't, but I watch anyway. Okay. Yeah. So if you need an update on Prince Harry, he was number 6 to the thrown to the King of England, right? Number six, which that's code for you ain't never gonna be king, okay? That's what that means. And he decided he was sick of it, the whole thing, so he married American actress Meghan Markle, and they moved to Hollywood to produce all sorts of films and did a media tour to tell people to leave them alone. Yeah. Awesome. And they live in Montecito, right, which is super fancy, and their next door neighbor is Oprah. Okay, so if Oprah is your next door neighbor and you're a newly retired prince, eventually you're going to end up on Oprah's interview show. Okay, so that's what we're going to see here. Now, the question that I have for you, remember, we're starting easy, we're getting harder as we go. The question that I have for you, is he always going to love his father? Okay, got it? Is he always going to love his father? Here we go.
Your relationship with your father? Is he taking your calls now?
Yeah. He is. There's a lot to work through there. You know, I feel really let down because he's been through something similar. He knows what pain feels like. And this is, and Archie's his grandson. But at the same time, you know, I will always love him.
Okay. Be ready to vote here. How many of you think he will always love his dad? Raise your hand. How many think he will not always love his dad? Raise your hand. Ooh, we got a lot of votes. Okay. So here's what I think. If I was doing an investigation, I think he will. And let me tell you how I'm going to get there on that. Okay. So there's a lot of emotions going on here. So Brits, do we have any British people with us? One. Okay. So back me up on this. British people do not do emotions. That is not their jam. No, never of them shall they speak. Okay. And so I think he's doing the British thing of stuffing everything in there as tight as he can. So you're laughing because it's true. Yeah. And it's leaking out. I think he's super angry. I think he's super stressed. And I think he will always love his dad. Now, let's unpack all this. The question wasn't, will you always love your dad? That was not the question. The question was, and your father, which is a very different question. Okay? He's the one that took it that direction. So, when Harry gets stressed, because I've watched the Netflix series, 6 hours of my life, I will never get back. And I do analysis all the time in the media on Harry and Meghan, because they get a hold of me. I think he's super stressed. I think he's really angry. And I think he's expressing an extreme dislike for the situation when he nods his head, or sorry, shakes his head this way. Okay, so I want you to, because we're expanding what we're looking at now. Okay, it's not just a head nod and a head shake anymore. Okay, we're done with that. Okay, file it away. You're going to be able to use it. Now, let's look at his eyes. He flutters his eyes in an irregular pattern. It is impossible to control your blink rate for more than a few seconds. It's impossible. Okay, and so they're very telling on if someone is stressed or not when they have an irregular blink rate, okay? Now, a regular blink rate is about 17 to 22 blinks in a regular pattern per minute. Here, what we see is blink, 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 pause, blink, 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 pause. He does it several times, blink, 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 okay? So that's how you know that that's a leak of stress, okay? Now, he sticks his tongue out 5 times. When someone sticks their tongue out, that says anger. Okay? So I think he's super angry. And it can be like, again, an extreme distaste. Okay? Which is like, if someone gave you like a lemon to eat and you ate the lemon, you'd be like, ugh, right? Like that. So it's a cousin of that. Now, so let's watch for that. And then get into the feeling of it. Get into the feeling of it. This is where the art and the science come together. Okay, and you'll see him, he will close his eyes for an extended period of time. When people do that, it's something they don't want to see. Okay, so I think he's getting into the negativity of the family emotion around, like, especially between him and his father. So you want to watch it again? There's a lot to look at. Okay, here we go.
Your relationship with your father? Is he taking your calls down?
Yeah. He is. There's a lot to work through there. You know, I feel really let down because he's been through something similar. He knows what pain feels like. And this is, and Archie's his grandson. But at the same time, you know, I will always love him.
All right. How many of you have a different analysis than you did originally? Anybody? Anybody think he is going to love his dad? Yeah, it's okay if you don't. Here's the thing. I was in Montecito not long ago. I had lunch with Harry and Meghan on my calendar. Turns out it wasn't on theirs. So so we're never going to know, okay? However, that's my best analysis, right? Because you can assess or you can guess. And with the assessment of the signs present, that's what we got. So for him, I'm going to give him a true. I'm giving him true on the truth-o-meter. Yeah, question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And you look like you're from India or somewhere. Yeah. So it's different over there. Okay. I am an American body language expert. I know enough to tell you that I do not know what goes on in India besides this. Everyone has their unique pattern, right? Because it's my understanding that folks over there will say, they'll nod their head and say, it's opposite. It's hard to do. So they'll say no. Right, and things like that. So what you got to lean on is your cultural knowledge, right, but also people's baseline, because people have a normal way that they behave, which brings us to this next concept of the number one thing that you really want to start to pay attention to with folks is not just the nod of a head. Yeah, question.
Sorry.
Oh, no, you're good. No, it doesn't supersede it. That's a good question. So the question is, does the eye blinking and the head nod supersede it? No, it all goes together. So we have anger, stress, and a highly negative feeling of something that he doesn't want to see, right? So it's all together. Because you can have several emotions at once. It's called a synesthesia is what it's called when multiple things are going on at one time. Okay, so again, what we're doing is knowing more than is immediately obvious to help you make different decisions. Okay, so let's talk about baselines for a minute. A baseline is it's something that you do. Okay, it's the number one thing that you want to do. It's what I was doing all those years ago when I was keeping track of people. Okay, so it's obtaining, I'm gonna see if I can read it just right to you, obtaining relevant information regarding a subject's behavior during non-invasive questions to determine if deception, it might be present in the future. Okay, so that's super fancy. That's from military interrogator Chase Hughes. That's his... He likes big words. Okay, so the point is, people have a normal way that they behave. When they get stressed, they're going to do things differently. They're going to do things, the cognitive load raises, and the brain can't function normally anymore, okay? And the body language is what changes, okay? And that's what I was looking for on the bike all those years ago, and it's what you're going to be looking for now. Because you all have members and vendors that you deal with all the time. But have you really paid attention to how they normally do things? Like for real? So you can see when it changes? I bet you're going to start to now, right? Now, there's different things that you want to start to look for. Now, and these are just a few of them. You got verbals and you got nonverbals. Things like, are they still or fidgety? Let's see, are they even volume, like loud to soft? Do they stutter? Are they fluent? What's the timing of their words? Okay. Are there certain signs that they use over and over that suddenly disappear when the line of questioning gets a little bit more intense, right? So these are some of the things that you want to start to just calibrate and just understand for each individual how it comes together. Okay. Now, so you want to start to do that all the time. And here's how we're going to study this, right? Because one day, Lance, you know, our pal Lance, one day he woke up. And he said, today is the day. Today's the day that I'm going to admit all of my performance-enhancing drug use. So what do you do when you need to admit things, right? Who do you call? Exactly. You call Oprah. That's exactly what you do. And so he, you know, any of us would do that. And so that's what he did. And let's just notice a couple things. What's different about this video and the first set of videos that we watched? And do you think he's telling 100% truth? Are there any signs that might say, hang on, wait a minute, this is mostly true, but like maybe not? I don't know. Let's just see what you think, okay? Really what we're doing is noticing for a shift in baseline here. Here we go.
Did you ever take banned substances to enhance your cycling performance?
Yes.
Did you ever blood dope or use blood transfusions to enhance your cycling performance?
Yes.
In all seven of your Tour de France victories, did you ever take banned substances or blood dope?
Yes.
All right. What was different? What did you notice that was different in this video from the first set of videos? Anybody? He was more comfortable with his answers.
Confident,
right? Okay, that's good. Okay, anybody else?
His head agreed with what he was saying.
His head agreed with what he was saying. Not only that, but this brings up the study from Elizabeth Loftus down at the University of Texas, who said, truthful people do and say the minimum that they need to do and say to get their point across. Okay, so first set of videos, he was a bobblehead, wasn't he? He was a bobblehead. And here, he's yes. One word, yes. Yes, right? So the first set of videos, it was I have never doped. And here, it's just one word, yes. Okay, what else?
His eyes.
Let's table that. I have a better example for eyes coming up, okay? This is like a little bit, but not enough right now. But just keep watching people's eyes. Okay. Now, what else? Exactly. Ooh, shoot, I just blew that out. exactly. He wasn't defensive. Okay, so that brings us to really his tone. Okay. So convincing is when someone uses a convincing tone, that's often connected to deception. Conveying is often connected to truth. Okay? So again, that's on the scale of the baseline, convince versus convey. Right? So you start to see, wait, we have a lot to listen for. Not only just things to watch for. Right? So very good on that. Very good. Anybody else?
It's like you didn't want to say his lips, it was like he took
a, oh, right. Okay.
Took
yeah. So he rolled his lips in over his teeth. He sucked his lips in. That's a fancy word for that. It's called lip insertion. This is what it's called. And whenever you see people do that, like you're doing it right now, see, you didn't even know you were doing it, did you? Yeah. So when that happens, people are holding back one of two things. They're holding back information or they are holding back emotion. And here, yeah, what are you holding back? Do you want to share? Would you like to share with us? No. Okay. Okay. She's just practicing for later. Okay, so 1 second and I'll be right with you. So when, and this is super important, when you see this, especially the lip insertion, okay, and really it counts whenever they stick anything in their mouth. Right now this is lips. They could stick their finger in their mouth or a pen, anything. They could start biting their nails, like that kind of thing. And I see you playing with your fingers right there. Are you holding your, I can see him. He's like, trying to hold himself back. Okay, so you have to take that moment because you've created a moment of cognitive load, right? And we've been talking about cognitive load. You've created that moment, and it's up to you to exploit it. And exploit's a very extreme word. However, if you don't take advantage of that moment, you have lost all of the effort that you've put in to possibly get the truth from someone, to get an admission or to understand, because there may not be anything to admit, but you might need to understand what's really going on inside their mind so that you can answer those unspoken questions. Okay, so here's what you do, is you say, well, you gotta use two principles. One is silence, and you've probably all heard this, okay? You gotta ask a question, and then you gotta be quiet. You gotta ask a question like you expect an answer, and then be quiet. Here's the question that you ask. Seems like you've got more to say about that. It's actually more of a statement, I guess. So you go, huh, seems like you got more to say about that, and then shut up, okay? The next person that talks in that moment loses. Because you can create a situation where the cognitive load gets so high that it can become painful to keep that information in. And if you speak, you have ruined that moment. So you have to be comfortable. You have to be more comfortable being uncomfortable than they are. And you may be shocked what they say next, right? What they do to alleviate that pain inside, because you've created that moment, okay? So you're already really good at being quiet. Does anyone feel the stress just kind of start to go up like this? Yeah, you're already really good at it. Use it strategically for moments that you know that there's more information there. Okay, so I think you did really good at picking out just about everything in this video. I can tell that you work with people a lot. So yeah, Lance told about 25% of the story to Oprah, just to get ahead of a very incriminating report that was coming out the next week. And I asked his dad, because his dad, I met on a plane not long ago. And when I figured out that he really was who he was, and he answered a lot of the questions that you wouldn't know unless you were there. Just right. I said, we pulled out my computer and I said, you ever seen anything like this? And he's like, yeah, that's how Lance likes to do things, right? He always does that. He's looked like that since he was 14 years old, right? So what does that say? That's a baseline pattern, right? And he also said, he goes, look, Lance did this because he had to look like the good guy, that he always has to look like the good guy. And that, I will tell you, is a hallmark trait of a narcissist. And narcissism has been in the news a lot the last few years, probably because of politics. And I'm here to tell you, team, it is on both sides. It is on both sides really heavy of people that have to look good. And you're going to know when you bump up against these people. Okay, and so the way that the scale goes in common nomenclature, right? So you got narcissists, and guess what? Every single one of us in this room is on the narcissist scale. Every single one of us. You might not be really high, okay, but everyone has to take care of themselves, right? And then it goes into more like sociopath and then psychopathic, okay? Now, all psychopaths, because that's in common media these days too, probably because of all the true crime shows that are out there, okay? And I know you watch them. All sociopaths are narcissistic, but not all narcissists are sociopaths or psychopaths, right? So, and it has to do with your ability to actually have empathy, or show emotion at all, okay? So if you're high on the scale, the only emotion you may be able to have is rage and anger. And a lot of those people, if you're really high like that, they're in jail. Like 80% of folks in jail are on a scale about like that. But here's the other problem. A lot of folks who are high on the narcissism scale are very high performers. Your life is filled with high performers, okay? So here's what's great about that, is the people that are the better liars are of low socioeconomic status. People that make a lot of money, people that are very high performers of high status are really bad liars, okay? I have a friend, the worst liar I know, has 2 PhDs. Okay, so you got a leg up on everything going to be going on in your club now, okay? So Lance only told about 25% of the story. I think it's a shame to lie to Oprah. I think it's a shame. And so here's what we're going to do, though. We're going to say, liar, liar.
Pants down.
Yeah, pants on fire. So how are you going to use this? Well, I know you're hiring. A lot of you are understaffed, right? A lot of you are. And did you know, and this is a study for the Society of Human Resources Management, that 40% of people lie in a job interview in a material way, either in the interview or on a resume. And I talked to someone in here to get ready for this. Even things like, hey, how are your Excel skills? Right? Or how are your PowerPoint skills? And they say, oh, fine. Like, that would be really handy to know if it's not to the level that you need. Right? And this person that I interviewed told me that they handed this new employee, I think it was an assistant, 70% done PowerPoint. All they had to do was just finish up the little touches of it. And they said, how do you expect me to do that? He goes, because you said you really knew all about PowerPoint. And he goes, well, yeah, but not to this level. Okay, so it's really handy to know that kind of stuff. So anyway, you're going to be able to see that now before it hurts you later. Okay, now, have you been having a nice time up to now? Having a good time?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, cool. Learning a little bit? Yeah, got some new skills? You want to really put them to the test? You want to solve a crime? Or at least get some insights on a crime? Anybody? Yeah, okay. A few of you? Okay. You want to solve the JonBenet Ramsey murder? Anybody? You remember JonBenet Ramsey? Little six-year-old beauty queen, Boulder, Colorado, lived about a mile from where I live now. And she was found dead in the family's home, Christmas night, 1995. It's still unsolved. And at the 20-year mark, her brother, Burke, and also her dad decided, you know what? We don't want to admit anything, but we want to talk. We want to talk. So if you want to talk in this country, but you don't want to admit, who do you call? No, you do not call Oprah. That's not who you call. Y'all need to update things a little bit in your mind. You call Dr. Phil. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows that. This is like Oprah and then Phil. Okay. So we're going to see a quick video. Now, some of you are probably thinking, gosh, it's got to be hard to get someone's baseline. Is anyone kind of worried about that? You're like, oh, I don't know if I can get someone's baseline. Yeah, it's okay. It can happen really fast. Okay, this is what small talk is for. This is what non-invasive questioning is for. And I'm going to tell you, we're going to get Burke. That's her brother's name. He was about 9 years old at the time. We're going to get his baseline with three questions. The first three questions that are asked. It's about, pineapple, a baseball bat, and a flashlight. Okay, so he's going to get asked questions about that. And that's his baseline. So one of the things I want you to report back on is what is his baseline? Okay, and then the questions get more incriminating, and I'm going to give you a little hint. Okay, you may see some things that you've already seen. And the new tool in here is that when you can see the whites of someone's eyes, that says fear. Okay, so you got a lot of tools. What's his baseline? And what do you think his involvement is? Those are the two questions that you want to come out with. Okay, here we go.
Did you and she eat pineapple together at any time during the day?
Maybe. Like, I don't remember specifically eating pineapple, but very well could have. Like, would you remember eating pineapple 20 years ago? Like, you know.
There was a flashlight and a baseball bat found at the house, and the investigators thought one of those could have caused JonBenet's head wound. Did they show you either of those items?
They showed me a picture of the baseball bat, like, on the side of the house or something.
Yeah. Did you hit your sister over the head with a baseball bat or a flashlight?
Absolutely not.
If someone in your house did, do you think you would have heard it?
Probably. Yeah.
Let's clear this up once and for all. Did you do anything to harm your sister, JonBenet?
No.
Did you murder your sister, JonBenet?
No.
Oh, it's so dramatic with the music, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. So, what'd you see? What's his baseline? First things first. What's his baseline? Anyone catch it? Do what? He's wordy. He's nervous. Let's get into. I don't know about the wordy exactly. Okay. Fidgety a little bit. Someone said his fingers. So okay. So the fidgeting. This is actually any small repetitive movement is called an adapter or a pacifier, and it's designed to let off stress. Okay. So let's talk about what stress could he be under besides that he showed up for this. Okay. No one made him. It's different than a police interview, okay? So what's there? He knows he's going to get asked questions about his sister, and there's all kind of lights. There's probably 200 people watching him, right, crew. And do you think that might make you a little bit nervous? Absolutely. Absolutely. So this is what he's doing to let off some of that steam. Okay, what did you say?
Was it a nervous smile?
The smile. Okay, so this is when someone always says, Traci, don't you see that? He's so creepy. That's how murderers look. Okay? That's when someone always says that. Okay? Now, here's the thing. Murderers, they might stare at you a little bit more if they're on the psychopathic scale. Okay? Often they will. However, with this, it's different. It's really different. We don't know exactly what's going on with him, but we know that that's his baseline. That's the baseline that we have to work with, is that smile. Right? And let's talk about the smile just for a minute. Because his mom was a beauty queen, right? And what do beauty queens do? Smile. Beauty queens smile through the pain. So would it be plausible that he's fallen back on old training of what to do when things get difficult? Yeah, absolutely. Right? So he could be falling back on that. Right. What else?
Eye contact.
Okay, so everybody has their own baseline for eye contact. And this is deeply unconscious. Some people have what's called a look-to-talk rule. And others, you see that their eyes roll around in their head. Okay, now the eyes in this case really are the window to the soul. We all have patterns of where we look for information. You've probably seen some of those neurolinguistic eye pattern charts. Like if someone looks up and to the right, they're remembering. If they look to the left, they're lying. Like all these kinds of things. That's really, really not accurate. So if you have one of those books on your shelf at home, one of the things I want you to do is go home, open to that page, tear it out, wad it up, and throw it away. Okay? Because it's going to be wrong. You got to compare people to themselves. Compare people to themselves. Now, what we saw in the first three questions is he would answer the question, and then his eyes go up, down, cross. And then he answered the question again, and his eyes go in the same pattern, up, down, cross. And then he does it again. That's his baseline. And then the questions get more incriminating. Right? And Dr. Phil asked a great one, and write this down if you're writing stuff down. He didn't say, did you hear anything? He didn't say that. He said what he did was ask a question specifically designed to increase cognitive load, and we saw the results of it. Do you think you would have heard something? It's causing him to construct information in his mind. Do you think you would have heard something? Okay, so write that down. Do you think you would have? What would it have been like if? Okay, that'll increase cognitive load. And then we saw the results of it. Because his eyes got really big. He rolled his lips in. And he goes, yeah. Right? So we saw fear and holding back information. And he goes, yeah, I would have. Now, at this point, and I know because Dr. Phil's really, really good at this stuff. He's not a TV quack, okay? He's a very skilled forensic psychologist. I know he saw what happened next with the eyes, with the whites of his eyes, with the rolling the lips back in, and the answer to the question. But he kept going down his list of questions, probably because this is Hollywood. He has to want the next person to come on his show. If he goes for the jugular right here, no one's going to want to come on his show, right? Even in a moment of high cognitive load. Now, in your world, you got to take advantage of that when you're doing any kind of interviewing, any kind of investigations, right? And so you got to dig a little bit deeper. And you got to say, huh, what would it have sounded like? What do you think it would have sounded like, right? Digging a little deeper. What would the relationship between John Monet and whoever did this to her have been like, right? Digging a little deeper. And what do you think should happen to whoever did this? And that question right there, what do you think should happen to whoever did this? That'll tell you guilt and innocence instantly. Instantly. Because the people who did it will go, you know what, they should be given a second chance. They're probably just having a bad day. It's true. That's what they'll say. But people who were maybe victimized by this or didn't do it, they'll be like, jail. They should get fired. They should go to jail. Okay? So write that down too. If you're writing stuff down. Right? And you got to get it so it rolls off your tongue a little bit more easily. But yeah, what do you think should happen to someone who did this? Right? Okay, so knowing what happened, right, and knowing his baseline, what do you think his involvement is? Anybody have an idea? What do you think his involvement is? Someone said witness? Where can we get to just, like if this was the only information you had? I'll tell you where I can get. Do what?
He has knowledge.
He has knowledge. I think he heard something. I think that's what we've uncovered here. Could there be more? Yeah, but he definitely heard something. So I think what we got to do is call it like we see it and just say, liar, liar. Yeah. So you can start to see, like, there's really a lot to look at in a little bit of time, right? And so, you know, these are some of the things you're going to get into, especially because I was talking beforehand about workers' comp incidents, right? Are you sure they just didn't pour the water on the break room floor themselves, like before they slipped on it, right? Like all that's really expensive. That's really expensive. Like to not get to the bottom of things like that, right? So now you got some tools to do it. But this is heavy. Are you feeling heavy? You're feeling a little bit heavy in your heart. You want to lighten it up just a little bit? I think you do. Okay, so. Let's do this one. Can we do this one? Would this be okay? A little deflate gate. What happened to 2 pounds of air in the footballs? Now I know he's probably your boy here, right? Here in Tampa. But here's what I want you to do. Get your pen out. If you don't have a pen out, get a pen out. And write down the first word that came out of your mouth or came into your mind when Tom Brady's picture came up on the screen. One word. What was the word? Don't think. Just quick. Do it. Yeah, someone says hot. Someone's going to say goat. Someone's going to say liar. What? Hate. Someone's going to say hate. All right. Yeah, that's okay. It's all okay. So you got your word? Everybody got your word? Yeah. That's your bias. Bias will mess you up every time. And you got to know what it is going into any kind of situation so that your analysis can be as correct as it can be. Because bias will help you not see things that you need to see. And it'll help you add in things. It'll help you add in things that you want to be there. Okay, so just know going in, there's no way to get around it, but you got to know what it is, okay? So some of you are going to cheer with this, what we're doing. And others, your heart's already broken, okay? So take a look with fresh eyes, okay? To the best of your ability, put that to the side. Put it to the side and go, what's the data? What does the data show? What happened to 2 pounds of air in the football? At the game before the Super Bowl.
It was cold.
Huh?
It was cold.
See, you're already justifying things away, okay? Maybe, unless you're not. Let's see what we got. Okay, there's going to be two segments, and know that there's no one sign for sure that shows deception on anyone. You want to get several cues in what's called a cluster, okay? So two little segments, maybe you'll see some things you see, maybe you won't. I don't know. Let's see what we got. Here we go.
You know, I didn't alter the ball in any way. I have no knowledge of anything. I have no knowledge of any wrongdoing of any.
Nobody did anything wrong.
Yeah, I'm very comfortable saying that. I'm very comfortable saying that Nobody did it. As far as I know, I don't know everything. I also understand that I, you know, was in a locker room preparing for a game for 5 hours. I don't know what happened over the course of the process with the footballs, because I would never do anything outside of the rules of play. I would never, have someone do something that I thought was outside of the rules. I was very shocked to hear it, so I almost laughed it off, thinking it wasn't, you know, that was more sour grapes than anything. And then it ended up, you know, it ends up being a very serious thing.
Then he was asked point blank if he was a cheater.
I don't believe so. I mean, I feel like I've always played within the rules. I would never do anything to break the rules. I believe in fair play, and I respect the league and, you know, everything that they're doing to try to create a very competitive playing field for all the NFL teams.
Okay. What do we see? First video. He's stuttering. He's stammering. He can't get a word out. Okay. And word error rate is a very high indicator of deception. Okay. Because here's what goes on. Your brain works at about 1,250 words a minute. Your mouth works up to 330 words a minute. That's where court reporters are tested to, 333 words a minute. And he's gone over three or four scenarios in his mind before it's time to open his mouth. And that's where you get the stuttering and the stammering. So you really got to pay attention to word error rate. It is meaningful. Do not justify it away. Right? And then he says, nobody did it. As far as I know, okay? So he qualified that statement. You got to watch out for qualifying statements. And that violates the rule of truthful people do and say the minimum that they need to do and say. So if he was being truthful, he'd say, nobody did it. Full stop, right? Instead, he opened the door to say, well, something could have happened. Like, but it didn't, but it could have, right? So two hotspots there in video number one. Second video, they asked him point blank, are you a cheater? And a lot happened before he opened his mouth. A lot happened. So we see him running in place. Did you see that? Right? Now our feet are the furthest from our head, okay? So we have the least control over our feet. And unconsciously, his unconscious mind is going, this is dangerous. We got to run. We got to get out of here. Let's go. And his conscious mind goes, nope, we're going to stay. Right? So this is what you get. You get running in place. So we get up to three hot spots, three or four at this point. And then he smiles really big. Do you see that smile? There's a term for that. It's called duper's delight. Okay, he's because he's having a good time with it. He thinks he's getting away with it. Whenever you smile at a very incriminating, potentially incriminating comment, question, it'd be a question. It's called duper's delight. It's very telling. We also saw that from Tanya Harding. Remember Tanya Harding? Yeah, I'll tell you how you can get that video in a little bit, okay? And then he rolls his lips back in. We talked about that. You just did it. Yep. Mm-hmm. And these three girls, you got to watch out for them. They are testing this out. They are trying to perfect it here before we leave. All right. So he rolls his lips back in, and then he said, remember, direct yes or no question. He said, I don't believe so. That's a lot of words. I'll give him two words max on that. I would hope for, you know, if someone asks you, are you a cheater? I would hope for no. maybe we could go with hell no, okay? But I don't believe so. That says, that's a lot of words, but it also says he's got some gray area. He's got some gray area he's working with in there, and I found out what it is. Because one of the Denver Broncos coaches was in one of my talks, and he, when I was done, he pulled me aside. He goes, here's the deal. He goes, for years and years in the NFL, kickers have been putting air in the ball, quarterbacks have been taking air out. He didn't do anything anybody else wasn't doing, but the Colts got sick of it. And $20 million later in lawyer fees and a 5-game suspension, was it four? Four or five? We have Deflategate. Oh, you know it's four? Yeah, Deflategate. And just based on this, what do you think? Do you think he did it? I'm going with yes. I'm sorry, Patriots fans and Tom Brady and maybe even Bucks fans. Now, we were friends before now, but we got to do it. We got to do it. And we got to say, liar, liar. That's right. That's right. So here's the deal. When you want to know more, okay, when you want that Tonya Harding video, get your phone out and do the QR code. You know how to do that. It's on your camera. And give me your email. I will email you videos of famous people lying on TV. So I got Tonya Harding, Sarah Palin. I got a bunch of them on there. Okay, so you can have that. And I'll put you on my mailing list once a month. People really like it. I've got the highest open rate at Constant Contact. And we talk about whoever is lying that month. So, and we never run out of things to talk about. Okay, so sign up for that. Now, let's see. Also on that page, you'll get my LinkedIn and my Facebook, so you'll get that, and also my podcast and hopefully TV show. So we're working in Hollywood, and maybe we'll come up with something that'll actually make it into your living room at 7 p.m. on Thursday night. I don't know, but you got to try. So I think now, do you want to put your skills to the test? Because we got a few minutes here. Yeah, we got like 15 minutes. Are we good? Yeah, Beth, we're good. Okay. You want to put your skills to the test? Yeah, a couple of you do? Okay, good. Because can you do me a favor and bring that chair up on stage? I have talked to a couple of you, and we're going to play a little, thank you. Can you bring that other one? Sorry, I'm giving you a new job. We're going to play a little interrogation game. So we can see some people lying right in front of us, or not, and then we can decide. Does that sound fun? Okay, cool. So let me see Michelle and it's Carl. Yeah, Michelle and Carl, come on up. Where are you? Let's see. They were here before. I know. Oh, there's Michelle. Oh, there's Carl. All right, give him a big hand. Come on, y'all. Hustle. Come on up. Okay. Come on up. If you're in a spot where you can't see that good, you're going to want to make sure you adjust yourself so you can see. So let's see. Michelle, why don't you sit there? All right. These are for you. Don't look at those. All right. Oh, and these two just met. So we're making friends already. Okay. Friends in deception. Here we go. Carl. All right. Have a seat. Now, I noticed Carl earlier because he's such a snappy dresser. So snappy. Okay, so here's how this is gonna go. Okay, it's called Real Confessions. You may have seen it on Jimmy Fallon, okay? Each of us, here's the official rules right here. In front of each of us are two envelopes containing confessions. Can y'all see Carl over there, or is the stage in the way? Let's scoot up a little bit, podium. There we go, okay. Very good. Now, in front of each of us are two envelopes containing confessions. One envelope is something that actually happened. So I have talked to them both in the last couple weeks, and I know something that actually happened in their lives. The other envelope contains a lie, okay? They do not know which envelope is which, and they do not know what the lie is, okay? So they're going to be on the spot. Because, audience, we are going to pick which envelope they open, and you're going to read your confession that's in there, okay? You're going to sell it like it's the truth. That is your script. Do not say anything that is not on that paper. Got it, Carl?
Got it.
Okay, good. Okay. Now, Carl's, he's thinking about it hard. You can do it, okay? Now, once you read your confession and you sell it, we're going to have, between me and the other player and the audience, we're going to have questions, and you got to be ready. So if you're lying, you're going to be lying rapid fire, okay? Now, if you're telling the truth, you're just going to answer truthfully. Got it? Okay, I can see you're a little worried. You see how her lips are tight there? That says silent disagreement. That's what that says. So she's a little worried. Now, so we're going to have a minute. Now, and then we're going to vote. We're going to see if we can tell who's lying and not. So you ready? Ready to have a little fun? Okay, cool. Who do we want to go first? Ladies first? I'm going to go ladies first. Ladies first. Here we go. Wait, let me, okay, we got that on. Okay, cool. Now, Michelle, How are you doing today? You doing good?
I'm doing very well.
Okay,
you.
Good, good. We need to get a baseline on Michelle, right? Because that's the most important thing that we can do. So, Michelle, because we're just going to ask her little questions, non-invasive questions, small talk, just to kind of understand how you normally do things, right? Because we just met.
Correct.
Yeah, okay, good. Now, so Michelle, where are you from?
I'm from Delray Beach.
Delray Beach. So you grew up there?
No.
No. Okay. So where are you from, Michelle? She's already lying. Okay. So,
all right. I'm from East Tennessee.
East Tennessee. Yeah. Okay. All right. What town?
It's Harriman, but Rome County. It's okay. Close to Knoxville.
Knoxville. Right. Okay. So are you like a Vols fan then? Or
no.
What happened?
No. I'm just not.
Okay. All right. She's just not.
My parents were not. I'm not.
Okay. All right. Now, let's see. Do you have any pets?
No.
No, no pets. Do you have any kids?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Are they like pets?
No.
No.
Well, three boys.
Oh, so they are like pets.
They
okay.
Are like pets.
Okay. So what are their names?
Justin, Jackson, and Jasper.
Okay. Now, how old are they?
19, 13, and 9.
Wow. Okay. So you spread them out a little bit. Okay. All right. Any other questions? Any other questions? I'm saying that like it was some kind of choice. Like, probably not. All right. Any other questions for Michelle?
Oh. Yes.
How do you have a 19-year-old?
Yeah. Oh.
Well, when two people fall in love. I thought your parents might have covered this.
Because you are crushing it, because you look really young. Okay, so I think that's what you meant, right? You were referring to her beauty. Yeah, compliment. Okay, good. Okay. Okay. So, I saved you there. You owe me. Okay. Now, so you got her baseline pretty well. You kind of know how she answers things. You got her volume. You got her pacing. Everybody got that? Okay. Now, which envelope do we want her to open? One or two? She's got two envelopes. Which one?
Two.
Two? They're saying two. So give me one. Give me one. I'll hang on to that. Now, pull that out of there. That is your script. Got it? Memorize it. Sell it like it's the truth. Okay, I'll take that. So we keep a clean stage. Yeah, she just got one. Okay, you watching how this goes? You're going to need this. Okay. Okay, ready? Hit it.
My husband and I had just attended.
That is not on the script. I know it's not on the script. Read this exactly. That's the script.
Verbatim.
Verbatim. Yes,
okay.
That's the word.
My apologies.
Verbatim. Okay, ready? So memorize it.
Yep.
Okay, and then sell it.
I snuck into a football game on game day.
Oh, you did? Okay. You got it? Okay, very good. That was good. Now, you ready? You got some questions? I got some questions. You snuck into a football game on game day. Mm-hmm. What game was it?
It was Georgia and LSU.
You snuck into Georgia LSU. That was on TV. Mm-hmm. And you snuck in?
Yes.
How? Did you sneak in?
After the game.
After the game?
Yes.
Okay.
So once the teams had left, there were still people on the field. My husband and I snuck on to the field.
How did you sneak on the field? Did you like go like over the rail or like what happened?
No.
Was it a celebration? Like what?
We put us there. We convinced one of the people that worked the stadium to walk us onto the field on the G. On the 50-yard line.
The big G. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. And do you have this picture?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
And nothing happened to you?
No.
It was a picture of a crime scene, is what you're telling me.
Correct.
Yeah. And nothing happened?
No.
No. Do you have any questions? What'd you say? What did you say to the... No, you're keeping going. We're keeping going. I want to know. I want to know what happened. Yeah, there's a time
limit. I didn't know there was a time limit. There was a gentleman that was down by the fence, and I said, oh, can we go and just get a photo really fast?
Uh-huh.
And he said, no, you cannot.
Uh-huh.
I was like, well, you know, we can just act like we're someone. Just you can walk us out there.
Uh-huh.
And I linked arms with him, and we walked out. My husband followed behind us.
So did he know you have a husband?
Yes.
He did?
Yes.
Oh, and he still did it.
He did.
And you linked arms with him.
Yes.
And that was that. So you persuaded him a little bit?
Correct.
Other questions? Anybody? I'm going to keep asking questions. What?
Yes. Georgia.
Georgia won the game. So did
go
you
dogs.
Did you have a ticket? Did you have let's try not to be partisan here. Now did you have a ticket to the game?
Yes.
You did? Okay. Other questions?
No
players left on the field. Okay, there was another one down there.
Would you have gone if they lost?
Yes.
When was it?
When? Like 8 to 10 years ago.
All right. Any other questions? Should we vote? How many of you think this is true? Raise your hand. Oh, we have a lot of truth. How many of you think it's a lie? Just a few. All right, Michelle, do the reveal. What is it?
It is the truth.
It's the truth. You snuck out of the field. Wow. So here's what she did. So a little bit of uncertainty is actually good when you're trying to pin down specific facts, right? Because oftentimes a liar will try to get more specific or they'll really minimize the number, right? Because she was like, probably 8 to 10, right? And you can kind of tell like her pacing was the same. She gave us a little bit of detail. She was like, I linked arms with this fella. And so, yeah, very good. So very believable. And it was true.
Okay, I'm honest.
Yeah, okay. Are you waiting for me to tell you if you were honest or not? Right, no. You did good. You did very good. Okay, sit there because you got to help with the next one. Okay, so Carl. You getting how this is going, Carl?
A little bit.
A little bit. Verbatim. That's the word of the day, Carl. So, let's do a little baseline. A little baseline for Carl. You ready? Okay. So, Carl, where
yes.
are you from?
Quebec City, Canada.
Quebec City, Canada. Okay. And where do you live now?
Lakewood, Florida.
Oh, okay. And how'd you get here? I mean, that's kind of far.
I drove.
You drove. Okay. Fair enough. Okay. So, all right. Okay. Carl, do you have any pets?
I do not.
You don't? Do you have a wife or a significant other?
Both.
Both. Oh, okay. Are they the same person, Carl, or are they different?
No, I was talking about my wife and my daughter.
Oh.
I have a wife, yes.
Okay, you have a wife. Both. You're the only person that ever said that, Carl. Okay. I've done this a lot. Okay. So, let's see. And then where else have you lived besides Quebec City? In here?
New Jersey.
New Jersey, the garden spot. Uh-huh. Okay. And how long did you live there?
About 5 years.
Okay. All right. Very good. Okay. So you got his pattern? You need any other baseline questions? I'm feeling pretty good. I'm feeling pretty good. All right. So which envelope do we want Carl to open? One or two? Which one?
One.
Okay. Give me two. And remember, verbatim, right? Okay. That's your script. You got to memorize it, and then you sell it like it's the truth, no matter what. Got it?
Yes.
Okay. Hit it.
I've been to a party at the Playboy Mansion.
Oh, all right. Well, well, well.
Not surprised.
Okay, all right, no, now we got some questions. Clearly we have some interest in Carl's activities. So, Carl, what year was this?
1993.
Oh, okay, and then how old were you in 1993?
I was 18.
18, okay. And how'd you get an invite?
My next door neighbor.
Oh, and who is your neighbor?
Don Funk.
Oh, Dan. Okay. And or Dan
oh,
or Don?
Don? Don.
Don. Don. Okay. And how did Don get invited?
He was a regular there.
He was a regular. Okay. And where were you living in 93?
California.
But I thought you hadn't lived in California. That wasn't on your list.
I did live in California as well.
Oh, okay. All right. Got it. Okay. And
you said a place earlier.
Oh, okay. Got it. Okay. And so where is the Playboy Mansion, by the way?
It is in California.
I got more questions. I got more questions, Carl. So, were any famous people there?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. And who were they?
Magic Johnson.
Magic Johnson was there at the Playboy Mansion.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Got it. And
not at that time.
All right. And were any bunnies there?
Real life bunny, no.
Real life bunny, no. What about the Playboy bunnies?
Yes.
Oh, got it. Okay. Carl, do you have any other answers besides yes and no?
White.
Was alcohol involved?
Yes.
How much alcohol, Carl?
A lot.
All right. And who did you go home with?
It was late.
Uh-huh. I didn't ask you what time was it, Carl.
I left with Don still.
Okay. You left with Don. I know there's more questions out there.
What did you wear?
Black and white.
Was it about your significant other?
It was not, but I could have.
Did you go to the grotto?
That was an expectation.
That was an expectation? So did you go or not?
Yes.
Oh, you did. Okay. And what did you find in the grotto?
Couple of bunnies.
Who has more questions for? Was there a theme?
Yes.
What was
Casino night.
Casino night. Okay, got it. Did you win anything at casino night?
Nothing I can share.
Okay, what other questions do we have for Carl? Oh, Beth has one. What color were your shoes?
They were black tuxedo shoes.
What color pin did you have on?
Black.
Oh, okay. All right. Here we go.
Was your suit black?
Yes.
Why would you wear a black pin?
That's a good question.
Do you always wear a pin? Is this your thing?
A little bit.
A little bit. Okay. Any other questions? Feel like we have enough? Okay. So it's time to vote. Should we vote? How many of you think this was the truth? Raise your hand. How many of you think it was a lie?
Yes, it was a lie. Oh, my.
His answers got really short. Did you notice his answers got super short? And now he was trying hard up here, right? And as soon as when we asked where was the mansion, did you hear the pause in the answer, right? So when people's pacing gets off, you go, wait a minute. People know where the Playboy Mansion is if they've been there. I guarantee you that. So not a good liar. Not a good liar, Carl. All right. Do you want to do?
I tried.
You did try hard. That was really good. Okay. Do you want to do me? Do we have a minute, Beth? Can we do me? Okay. Do y'all want to? Okay. Cool. All right. I'm gonna give these to you. I need you to make sure I get these back. I want to take these home. Okay. There you go. Okay. So, do you want envelope one or two?
Two.
I heard two. Okay. You said one. We're gonna go with two because he said two. All right. Now. You should have a good baseline on me because you've been watching me for like all afternoon, right? So,
I still think we should ask you some questions, though.
We're gonna get some questions. We gotta get this. We gotta do the setup. You're gonna ask. Okay. Ready? Here you go. I have been in a country music video. You ready? You gonna ask some questions? Here we go.
Yes.
Okay.
Who was the music video was for? Who was the artist?
Oh, Dixie Chicks.
What color were your boots?
What color were my boots? I was probably wearing like tennis shoes, like running shoes.
Which song?
Wide Open Spaces.
What year?
I bet it was 97 in there. 96. Why? Why was I in? Oh, I was in the crowd of the concert where they were filming.
Where was it?
It was at this place in Colorado, and it was, it's a little ski resort. It changes names all the time. It was kind of outside of Granby. It was like an outdoor concert.
Who were you with?
I was with myself. I couldn't find anybody to go, and I was like, I'm not going to this. So I went by myself.
Did you know you were going to be in the video when you went?
No.
Just random in the audience?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
When do you live in Dallas?
When did I live in Dallas? How is this related to the Dixie Chicks?
It's a question. Yes, it's it.
Oh. Okay. No, I left Dallas in 92. Y'all don't have any more questions?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Were you recognizable in the crowd, or were you one of
50,000? I'm just recognizable because I have a yellow coat on in the first few rows.
What time of year was it?
It was July.
And you had a coat on.
Well, it's cold. Have you been to Colorado in July in the mountains? It is cold. Yeah.
Where did you get your ticket?
Where did I get the ticket? Just wherever you get tickets. You know.
Did you buy it yourself?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
One ticket by yourself?
Yeah. You want me to sit around because I don't have anybody to go with? That's what it sounds like.
Is it on your LinkedIn page?
Is it on my LinkedIn? No, it is not. What is my favorite? It's probably Wide Open Space is my favorite one.
How long was the video? The shoot.
Oh, the shoot. I think they sang it twice, just to make sure. Yeah.
Leah's such a big fan. What were their names?
Well, you got Natalie, Marty, and Emily.
Can you name two other songs by the Dixie Chicks?
Can I name two other? Yeah, you got Goodbye Earl, quality song. And, well, it's like a how-to, right? Like, you need to get rid of someone. You know how to do it. And what's another one? It's escaping me right now.
Is that the song or it's escaping?
No, it's escaping me right now. Tonight, The Heartache's on Me. That's another one. Yeah.
How did you find out your video?
Well, they said that they were filming it, and then I kind of couldn't wait for it to come out, so I was like, I watched the premiere of it.
Do you remember another concert from them before?
Yeah, I've been to probably 5 or 7 concerts from them.
I think there's a question.
Do you have the sound release?
No. I think though what they did say was, if you're with someone that you shouldn't be with, we're filming. This is your warning right now.
How old were you?
How old was I in 97? Probably 22-ish, somewhere in there. Probably 22.
Who's your favorite Dixie Chick?
Favorite? I don't know if I have a favorite one.
Which one passed away?
None of them. One of the Dixie Chicks, did one of them pass away? I don't think so. Did they? Was that a decoy? No, I think they're all kicking, I think. Anybody else?
One last question.
One.
Was George Bush there?
Oh, I don't know. Was he? Do you know something I don't know? Was he in the back? It was George Bush. I don't, that's a weird question, Carl. All right, I think it's time to vote. Oh, wait, do we have one more?
Sure, it was 97?
It was like right in there. Yeah, like could have been, I don't think it was 96. It would have to have been 97. It could. 98, yeah, it could have been 98, but it was. It was definitely, I graduated college in 96, and it was definitely after that by about a year-ish, so. Okay, and I know y'all are trying to ask in your mind, like, how old is Traci? I just turned 50. Okay, so there we go. We'll get that out there. So I think it's time to vote. Are you ready to vote?
Yes.
Okay, how many of you think it was a lie? How many think it was the truth? It is the truth. Why would you think I was lying? What?
I think you tried too hard.
You think I tried too hard?
Yeah, you were too vague.
Too vague?
You're trying to be too vague.
Yes. I'm a professional liar? You think I'm a professional liar? Oh my gosh, I am not. I am not a professional. No, it is totally true. If you watch, you can see the, like, turn on the video and there's like a yellow coat. Yeah, look in the crowd shots, yellow coat. And I'm wearing the yellow coat and I'm not closer up because I went to my car because it started to rain. and I needed a jacket, and it was like really cold. And I came back, and I couldn't get my original spot where I was standing. So that's why I'm a little further back than could have been. So anyway, that is that. All right, so here's what we know is you're pretty good. You're pretty good at your lie detection skills, and you got a little more work that you need to do, but we all do. So I'm going to send you two back. Oh, thank you for this. And give them a big hand, but you get a copy. Here you go. You get a copy of my book, How to Detect Lies, Fraud, and Identity Theft. There you go. Thank you so much. You're very brave. You're very brave. Okay, so let's see. We've got to let this run out. We got to get, I'm running late. I'm sorry. I'm running late. So if you did not get a book, if you didn't win one, I have a few with me. They're $15. I'll sign them for you. It's a really good...